Good day, everyone. Welcome to Prayer Watch. Thank you for being with us again. Let us pray. We bless your holy name, O God, O Almighty God, our Father in heaven. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of your love, your life, and provision day by day. And today, as we come together once again to look into your word, we ask that your Holy Spirit will continue to abide with us, to give us spiritual wisdom for your spiritual words. Lord, we also ask that you prepare our hearts and our minds. Please forgive us, Lord, our sins, and take away any barrier that could stand in the way of our coming to you, of our listening and understanding. We praise you, Lord, for your promise to us that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you, Lord, for your great love, your forgiveness, and your cleansing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy.
Universe declares your majesty. Matthew 12. Then they brought him a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute, and Jesus healed him, so that he could both talk and see. All the people were astonished and said, "Could this be the son of David?" But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, "It is only by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons." Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. If Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand? And if I drive out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your people drive them out? So then, they will be your judges. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I drive out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or again, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can plunder his house. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters."
We praise and thank God for his wonderful words of life. Could this be the son of David? Who is this Jesus? Up until that time, the identity of Jesus was a big question mark. As soon as he began his earthly ministry, Jesus wasted no time in preaching, teaching, healing the sick, and casting out demons. Yet the people from his hometown and the neighboring provinces, and even all the way to Jerusalem and Judea, did not seem to have a clear idea as to who he was. Because of the miracles, some thought he was Elijah, in whose time God performed many miracles, or some even thought he was Jeremiah or one of the prophets. As Matthew 12 notes, some wondered whether he was the son or descendant of David, who would sit as their king, the promised Messiah who would eventually free them from Roman rule. They were inclined to think that way, but then again, they were not so sure. In Matthew 12, once again, Jesus had just cast a demon from a man who was blind and mute and healed him so that instantly he was able to see and to talk. Everyone was amazed at this supernatural sign, but the Pharisees discredited the miracle and attributed it instead to the power of Satan. Today, after more than 2 millennia after his death and resurrection, Jesus' identity still remains an issue with many people. Despite the many historical evidences, there are those who deny he actually existed or that he resurrected from the dead. And those who recognize his earthly ministry could not deny that he was a master teacher. Why? His teachings are preserved in the Bible, and it is indeed difficult to conclude that he could be otherwise. His teachings are praised by men from all walks of life, from every persuasion and every faith or religion. His miracles also are documented in the Bible. He also claimed to be the Son of God, meaning that he was coming from, or that he was of the nature of God. He claimed to be one and the same with God the Father, meaning to say he claimed to be God himself. Yet, after taking all these premises together, that he was a masterful teacher, that he was a good man, that he taught truths with authority, that he was a miracle worker with supernatural powers attributable to divine power, it is baffling that people would come up with a conclusion that he was only a good man and a masterful teacher. But if he was both, then how could he claim to be the Son of God if it weren't true? If he were a masterful teacher and a good man who could be trusted in his teachings about God, and that he was able to prove his supernatural power with miracles, is it not logical to believe that he must be the Messiah and the Son of God that he claimed to be? Mahirap bang paniwalaan na siya ay Diyos at siya yung tagapagligtas, siya yung Mesiyas na matagal nang nasa propesya at hinulaan dahil sa lahat ng kanyang mga ginawa, dahil sa galing niya sa pagtuturo, dahil sa katotohanan at lalim ng kanyang mga tinuro, dahil sa kanyang buhay? Bakit ba nahihirapan pa rin ang mga tao na tanggapin ang sinasabi o pinapatotoo ni Jesus tungkol sa kanyang pagka-Diyos? We can only conclude that the problem does not lie in Jesus' puzzling identity, but in the people who could not come up with logical and reasonable conclusions given the facts, given their experience. What does Jesus have to say about such persons? Is there a chance that even those who claim to be believers of Jesus are not really with him, but against him? In Matthew 12, we get a glimpse of the Pharisees' problem. We are told that Jesus had just healed a demon-possessed man. It was a miracle, and the masses were so amazed, they were beginning to believe that he was indeed the prophesied Messiah. But the Pharisees brushed off the miracle and immediately concluded that Jesus' power was not of God, but from Satan. Now in response, Jesus challenged their line of reasoning by saying, "How could Satan cast out or fight the demons who are under his rule? Kung si Satanas ang nagpapalayas kay Satanas, kinakalaban niya ang kanyang sarili. Kung gayon, paano pa niya mapapanatili ang kanyang kaharian? Hindi ba't taliwas yun sa tamang pag-iisip? Baluktot ang ganoong pag-iisip, hindi po ba? Dahil ba hindi nakapag-iisip ng matuwid ang mga Pariseo at sila ay dumating sa ganoong conclusion? O baka ang problema ay ang puso ng mga Pariseo?" Sometimes people lose their rational minds when they lose the heart to seek the truth. Minsan, nawawala sa tamang pag-iisip, no? Ang mga taong nawawalan ng kanilang talagang totoong pagnanasa na hanapin ang katotohanan. Maaring may mga tao na gusto na lang na manatili sa mga bagay na sa mga kasinungalingan na gusto nilang paniwalaan, o gusto nilang manatili na lang doon sa kanilang mga pinaniniwalaan kahit na mayroon ng mga ebidensya na hindi totoo ang kanilang dating pinaniniwalaan. The Pharisees wanted to insist on their own comfortable ideas of religion, of being right with God. They were used to the traditions called for in the law of Moses, the rituals, and even the guidelines on what is right to do on a Sabbath, like what is the proper sacrifice, how many times they should pray in a day, tithing, and all. But these observances, sadly, served to make them proud of their accomplishment, rather than to humble themselves before God and to draw them closer to his heart of purity and love, mercy and generosity. Sadly, their preconceived notions instead of making them focus on God, made them focus on themselves, their respectability, to have compassion on the needy was no longer their aim, but rather they were more concerned with their own needs. A comfortable religion. The Bible says that the gospel is veiled to those who are perishing because the God of this world has blinded the minds of such people so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Mayroon daw ganoon na nangyayari sa mundo. Ang espiritu ng kasamaan ang nagbubulag sa kanilang isip, no? Upang hindi nila makita ang liwanag ng salita ng Diyos tungkol sa kalwalhatian ni Kristo na siyang larawan ng Diyos. Kaya alam natin na may ginagawa din, no, ang kalaban upang pigilan, harangin ang ilaw ng katotohanan, ang siyang magbigay ng kaliwanagan sa isip at puso ng mga tao. And so after pointing out the irrationality of the Pharisees, Jesus made an illustration about the reality of spiritual warfare. He said, "How can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can plunder his house." You see, there is this battle of powers. Meron pala talagang tumatakbo na ang paglalaban-laban ng dalawang puwersa dito sa mundo. Ang sabi ni Jesus, "In the case of the demon-possessed man, his body was then inhabited by the demon that oppressed him spiritually. The demon-possessed man was the strong man's house." Yung sila ay yung taong ito na binahaya na, sinaniba na ng demonyo, ay ginawa ng parang tahanan ng espiritu yon, ng masamang espiritu yon. So he has become a strong man's house. Malakas ang kapit ng espiritu ng kasamaan na ito sa kanyang buhay. But someone stronger came into the demon-possessed man's life. And that is Jesus. Jesus tied the powers of Satan, rescued the man from being under the power and possession of Satan. When Jesus' power came into this demon-possessed man's life, it was as if the powers of Satan were bound, no? Natalian ang kapangyarihan ni Satanas na nagpapahirap doon sa taong yon, dahil mas malakas ang kapangyarihan ni Jesus sa mundo. By the power of God, Jesus took Satan's hold from the man and released him so that even his physical sight and speech were restored. Here we can see that there is nothing in our life that needs to remain under Satan's domination, for Jesus Christ's power is superior to any power of this world. Lastly, as Jesus demonstrated his power over satanic control, there is no way that people can remain neutral about their response to Jesus. The crowd were inclined to believe that he was from God. But the Pharisees were blinded by their pride, and they came to a distorted conclusion that Jesus was operating out of the devil's power. Jesus is speaking to us even now, even today. And he is saying that whatever be our response to his reality, to his person, to his teachings, to his power, it could not be a response of neutrality. So he said, whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Sinasabi ng Panginoong Jesus, hindi pwede na sa lahat ng kanyang itinuro, sa lahat ng kanyang ipinakita, sa lahat ng kapangyarihan ng kanyang napatunayan, hindi maaari ng isang tao nakakakita, nakakaintindi nito, ay manatiling neutral. Ibig sabihin, walang panig, no? Hindi naman para kay Jesus, hindi rin naman kalaban ni Jesus. Yung ganun ba, na nasa gitna ka lang, wala kang opinion, o ayaw mong pumanig, ayaw mong magpahayag ng iyong tunay na paniniwala. Ang sabi nga, sabi ni Jesus, ang hindi panig sa akin ay laban sa akin. At ang hindi ko kasama sa pag-iipon ay nagkakalat. What is your response to Jesus Christ? To His message? If you are non-committal, then you are against Him, said Jesus. Kung ayaw mong magbigay ng kahit anong opinion kung nasaan ka, no? Nakatayo ngayon sa iyong pananampalataya, ang sabi ni Jesus, yan ay para na rin kinalaban mo na siya. If you are not doing anything to gather people towards the truth of the gospel, you are as bad as scattering them or leading them away from the truth. If you prefer to remain a hidden or quiet Christian, not positively working together with Jesus in His vineyard to advance His kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, if you are just a passive onlooker or bystander, with no plan or no participation in our church mission, then in Jesus' sight, you are not neutral, but you are a negative influence. You are against Him. These are very grave judgments. But this only goes to show how important it is to live our lives as true followers of Jesus Christ, passionate to show that we are on His side, passionate to stand where He stands in issues of life, passionate to do something, to do our share in showing the world what Jesus means to us and what it means to be a Christian. In short, saving faith in Jesus Christ means a sincere repentance of sin and a deepening love that is fully devoted to His teachings and mission. Ang pananampalatayang nakaliligtas ay ang tunay na pagsisisi sa kasalanan at ang pagpapakita ng pag-ibig kay Jesus na tapat sa Kanya, sa Kanyang mga turo at sa Kanyang misyon. And so, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let us submit our faith to Jesus' test as we are now right within the week of, the very holy week that has been reserved for us Christians to reflect more and more about our relationship with our God and Jesus Christ. Let us submit our faith to Jesus' test, as He tested the people gathered around Him on that day when He healed a demon-possessed man. Are we truly for Jesus? Are we fully convinced that He is the Son of God, the Messiah, and Lord? And if so, is that faith evident in our response? Are we in awe of His supremacy over everything in the world? Do we judge everything? Do we see everything in the light of Jesus, in the light of His words, in the light of His love for the Father? Are we humbly submitted to His teachings? Are we spending our energies, our time, our efforts, our treasure, our talents, our lives for His kingdom purposes? To follow Him, to serve Him, and to bring the gospel and His word to others. Let's reflect upon these things and ask Him to help us. Ask God to help us to be true to our faith, to be true to Jesus, who is true to us. Let us ask God to unveil whatever blindness there may be, or that there whatever blindness may have crept into our lives. Who is Jesus really to us? Let us ask God to bring us back solidly to be for Him, to be on His side and not against Him, to be a channel of gathering people to faith in Jesus Christ and not to make them fall away on account of our unfaithfulness. Whoever is not for me is against me. Whoever does not gather with me scatters. May God help us return to Him with sincere hearts. And as Christians, truly mean it when we say that Jesus Christ, You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God, our Savior, my Savior, and my Lord. Shall we pray? Our loving God and Father in heaven, we ask, Lord, that You continue to grow the seed of Your word in our hearts. As we nourish them with prayers, as we nourish them with the study of Your words, as we nourish them, Lord, with worship and praise, as we nourish them with a sincere heart, a humble heart that is willing to learn from You, to be rebuked by You, to be softened by You. Dearest Lord, we want to truly be solidly on Jesus' side. We want to stand by Him. We are for Him. Lord, we want to be counted as those who are truly followers of Jesus Christ, who are His co-workers in the mission of bringing the gospel to those who have not yet heard the good news of salvation. There is no other way to go, O Lord, because that is the only way to You. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and He is the life. Lord, we ask that, especially on this very sacred time of reflection, this Holy Week, You will give us, O Lord, the opportunity to have a heart-to-heart conversation with You. Lord, please honor the prayers of Your people, those who are truly bowed down before You, humbled before You, O God, knowing that indeed, without You, we are nothing. Without You, we cannot do anything. In these times of trouble, in these times of intensified trials and temptations, Lord, we just ask for your strength to be upon us, your wisdom and the light of your truth and your word. We continue, Lord, to also pray for the peace of Jerusalem, the salvation of peoples around the world. We pray, Lord, for your peace to reign, not only the physical and political peace, but the spiritual peace that passes all understanding, to be upon the peoples who are now experiencing the ravages of war in Europe and in other parts of the world. We lift up to you the people of Russia and Ukraine, as well as your people and the residents now of Israel and all those who are poised to destroy her. We stand by her, O God, because you said that you will bless those who bless your people. Thank you, Father, for the privilege of being able to pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Goodbye for now, everyone, and may God indeed give us a blessed Holy Week.